there's this play at Playmakers featuring starring Joey Collins and featuring a choir and with Glenn Baerbock directing the music. And it is this powerful, thought-provoking play which asks some deep questions. For us, on the surface, what the play is about is universalism. The belief that a loving God would not condemn anyone to an eternity of torment and torture. Play is an exploration of this theology of the salvation and heaven and hell that is so much of our faith tradition's history. On another level, the play can be seen as an exploration of leadership and how communities behave and the difficulty they get themselves in. On a still deeper level, it can be seen as exploring the question of whether relationship, whether that's relationship is in a family or in a community or in a church, whether relationship is truly possible when there is disagreement about matters of fundamental importance. And still deeper than that, the play is an exploration of what happens when we follow our conscience. What happens when we go through a change, the type of change that changes everything, and we decide to be true to that change. I want to quickly tell you two true stories of change. The first true story I want to tell you is the story of Carlton Pearson. Carlton Pearson was a conservative, African-American Pentecostal preacher. He was a Grammy-winning gospel singer, a preacher trained by televangelist Oral Roberts, a minister of a megachurch with thousands and thousands and thousands of members in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and a star within the evangelical Christian movement. He hosted every year this Azusa conference of gospel music, Pentecostal gospel music, and over 2 million people around the world tuned in, either showed up or tuned in to watch this gospel music conference. One day, Carlton Pearson, with his not yet one-year-old daughter on his lap, was watching the evening news and saw a story about the refugee crisis in Africa following the Rwandan genocide. The news report showed women and children, some children no older than his own daughter, on the verge of death from starvation. In that moment, Pearson writes that he calls out to God. He says, God, I don't know how you can just sit on your throne there in heaven and these poor people drop to the ground and you just randomly suck them into hell. And in that moment, God answered him, telling him, that's not my plan. You just say that it is. God then revealed to Carlton Pearson that there is no hell, that everyone is saved. Over the ensuing years, Pearson begins to formulate what he calls the gospel of inclusion. He begins to shift his theology, and he gradually introduces these ideas to his church. He begins to preach and teach that no one is damned to hell. And all hell broke loose there. A schism ensues. People begin to leave his church, and the attacks come not only from within, but from without. Ministers around the country begin to attack him. They begin to preach that Carlton Pearson has been possessed by the devil and is doing the devil's work. The ministers call his parishioners to tell them to leave the church. Call the family members of his parishioners to try to get family members to put pressure on family members to leave the church. He is kicked out of the leadership positions, disinvited from conferences. He loses his position leading the Azusa Street revival. He is rejected and shunned. Over the ensuing months and years, he loses 95% of the members of his church and is forced to sell his building. I want to tell you a second true story. It's the story of Rob Bell. Rob Bell was the founding pastor of the Mars Hill Church located near Grand Rapids, Michigan. He started the church in 1999 when he was 29 years old, and within a few years, Sunday attendance grew to 10,000 people every Sunday. 10,000 people every Sunday. He was listed as one of the 10 most influential pastors in America. And in 2011, at the age of 40, he publishes a book called Love Wins, a book about heaven, hell, and the fate of every person who ever lived. He writes of some experiences that led him to write this book. He heard a story about the funeral of a 15-year-old high school student killed in a car accident. A 15-year-old who was an atheist. And he hears about the story, and he hears about Christians who tell the family and the friends of the boy who dies that he is in hell. Rob Bell describes an art show at his church. We've got an art show here, right? Where someone includes an image of Gandhi and an inspirational quote from Gandhi. And someone in his church who's at the art show comes and sticks a note on the piece of art that says, Gandhi is in hell. So Rob Bell wrote this book arguing for a bigger and more expansive heaven, a love that wins. He even denies being a universalist because, you know, that might get him into some trouble. And then the turmoil began. Members of his church leave. Christians around the country attack him and condemn him and go on television and write books to attack him. 6 months after Love Wins is published, Rob Bell announces that he is resigning as minister of his church. He denies that he was forced out, claims that he had the support of the majority, but he also admits that his book had become a distraction and a source of conflict. So here are two true stories from the past 10 years or so of very prominent, very successful, extremely accomplished Christian ministers who undergo spiritual transformations. They have theological epiphanies, and they decide to come out, to follow their own integrity, their own conscience, and to come out against their faith's teaching about hell, knowing that they're risking a lot, knowing that they may be rejected and shunned, knowing that their friends may forsake and abandon them. There's a part of me, a smug part of me, and yes, I know that smugness is not a theological virtue, that thinks of our religious tradition and says, we've been doing this for 250 years. Universalism isn't nothing new. John Murray, those words that we sang about give them not hell but hope, those were written in 1792. And Hosea Ballou and so many others, all those people I read about in seminary, they were preaching a gospel of inclusion. They were preaching that love wins as far back as the founding of our nation. You're not doing anything new, Rob Bell. Why aren't us UUs writing New York Times bestsellers about a loving God? It's our theology, after all. This guy doesn't lead me into a good place. But I also want to flip it and take a moment to reflect on some of the ways in which universalism has won, at least across liberal and mainline Christianity. The simple fact is this: if you go to almost any UCC or Quaker or Methodist or Presbyterian or Episcopalian or American Baptist church this morning, you won't hear hellfire and brimstone. In some of those churches, hell is openly and freely denied. In others, it's more cautiously avoided and not talked about. But in none of those traditions would a preacher say that Gandhi is in hell, or that the teenage atheist who dies in a car crash is in hell, or that the starving children in Africa need to be saved, converted, so that they do not go to hell. We're a small faith, but universalism has a much wider influence in our culture's religious landscape, and praise be for that. But what about the side of our culture's religious landscape that continues to preach the doctrine of hell? What What about fundamentalists and conservative evangelicals? What about those who say that only true Christians are saved, but Jews and Muslims and Buddhists and atheists are damned? Who say that Catholics and Mormons and anyone else other than born-again Christians are going to hell? What about those ugly souls who show up at the Pride March every year, thumping Bibles and holding signs threatening hellfire? In the play The Christians, God speaks to Pastor Paul and tells him to stop preaching about hell, tells him that everyone is saved, and this completely transforms him. And I think he believes that when he preaches this message that the result is going to be that everyone in his church is going to be grateful. We'll feel liberated. We'll feel like this burden can be laid down. That's not what happens. It's not what happens to Rob Bell. It's not what happens to Carlton Pearson. And I have to ask, why is this? Why do some folks continue to hold on to this idea of hell? Is it a preference for tradition? A longing to keep traditional ideas? Is it a desire to feel special, to feel a part of an exclusive club? Is it chauvinism? Is it a bigoted rejection of the complexities of diversity and multiculturalism? Is it a desire for some sense of justice in the cosmic sense, in a world in which so often the wicked prosper and those who do evil things are not held to account? Does hell offer for these folks a means of righting wrongs? Or is hell just the manifestation of our desire for vengeance? Does it show a kind of violent sadism that is a part of the human condition? Why is hell such a part of so many people's religious imagination? I struggle with this. But I also know the power that comes when we have that religious experience that leads us to move beyond this idea of hell. Carlton Pearson, who I talked about earlier, describes the experience this way. Before he embraced the gospel of inclusion, Carlton Pearson used to walk around, and as he walked around, in his mind, he would judge and condemn the people he came across in his day-to-day life. He'd be walking down the street, and he would imagine, damned, damned, saved, damned. He'd be in a store, and in the aisle in the grocery store, damned, damned, saved, damned. And then one day he was in an airport at a busy time of year. Have you ever been in a busy airport? I want you to imagine that you're in a busy airport. And he turns around, looks down the concourse, you know, the sea of humanity, and he begins this damned, 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 damned. And he felt in that moment not superior, but terribly sad, incredibly lonely. And he says that only when he came to understand that every single person around him was loved by God could he finally feel a connection with and a love for each person he encountered. I know what this feels like. I'm like Carlton Pearson or Pastor Paul or Rob Bell. I was never an evangelical. I was raised a Unitarian Universalist. But I had this experience when I was younger. I think back to this experience when I was younger of being one of the kids in high school who it was safe to come out to. And so I had a gay and lesbian and bisexual friends who I was, you know, probably maybe not the first person, but one of the first people who they told. When people come out to me, probably because I seemed safe, because I seemed like I wouldn't judge or condemn or reject. I know what that feels like, to be in this place of offering unconditional love instead of condemnation. It's one of the best feelings in the world, that type of connection. Pastor Paul, in the play The Christians, speaks of feeling like there is too great a distance between him and too many people in the world. When I talked with Joey about the service and asked him to participate. We were having dinner together, and he told me a story about a transformation that he went through. And it was powerful, and I thought, oh, we have to put this in the service. And so I'd like to end the sermon this morning by inviting Joey Collins back up to tell us a story.
This is me. I hope that you will find something rewarding at the end of this story. I was a born-again Christian when I was in my early 30s. I was in graduate school at SUNY Binghamton, upstate New York. And I had joined the young men's group at the church I was attending, and we, along with the young women's group, thought we'd have a lot more fun studying and worshiping together if we could recruit more Gen Xers, as we were called. So we decided to have a bonfire social, music, pizza, s'mores. We set the date, and we decided to hand out flyers to people in our age cohort. And this was in 1993, and the first Walmart was being built in the southern tier of New York. And we chose their parking lot as our recruitment ground zero, if you will. And so the Walmart Saturday comes for us to distribute these flyers, and I meet the church van and others at the university parking lot. And I am given an apron and a box of pamphlets. "Pastor Chris, where are the flyers for the bonfire?" we all ask. He says, "Chat people up, get them interested in the bonfire if they're of that age, and then bring them to me. I'll get their name and number." He holds up a clipboard. Okay. So I put on my apron. I sit in the van. I pull out one of these shiny new pamphlets. And the first one says, "Why, if you're a Catholic, you're going to hell." And then the next one read something like, "Spending money on an abortion means no ticket to heaven." And there was this kind of cheesy St. Peter image as a bus driver in the background of the pearly gates. But then the next one read, "Why the Holocaust was God's punishment to the Jews." And I felt sick. As the van pulls away, I started to sweat. I felt cold. I started shaking. My head was spinning. 5-7 minutes into the drive, I just couldn't take it. I copped a plea. I lied. I said, "Pastor Chris, I think I may have food poisoning or something. Could you please pull over?" And I realized then where we were. We were in Johnson City, and there was a bank at the next stoplight. And there were some houses that were converted into apartments there. And I say, "You know what, maybe I'm just car sick, but you know, I need to get out. But look, hey, you know, my friend Diana, she lives right up here by the bank. I'll just pull over here. Oh, look, that's her car. I'll get her to take me back. You guys go ahead." And then Pastor Chris's wife says, "Oh, no, we'll stay right here and make sure your friend Diana is home." Okay. I give her my apron and my box of pamphlets, and I walk up this sidewalk that I've never walked up before. And I look back and I see faces planted in the van windows. And I take a breath and I ring a doorbell. Now, I know my friend Diana does not live there. I didn't know who lived there. And a broad-shouldered woman opened the door. She had on a Wegmans t-shirt, which is a grocery store up there. And I said to her, "You don't know me, but I need your help. I'm not selling anything. I'm not a beggar. I'm with those people in that van, and they're asking me to do something that I just can't do. It's not right. And to get out of it, I lied to them and told them I felt sick, and then I tried to get them to just leave, and they wouldn't. And so I said that I knew the person in this apartment. Can you pretend to know me? Maybe let me inside just until they drive away, and you go back to doing what you're doing, and you'll never see me again. And without a beat, she put her arm around me, and she waved to those people in that van, and she says, "It's okay, I'll take care of them." She said she had an accent, and she let me in. And she made me some tea, and I was still shaking. And I couldn't stop crying for a long time, and I was embarrassed. I felt stupid for not standing up to Pastor Chris and everybody. She was a single mom. She had three jobs, three daughters, and I think she was a widow, but my memory's not sure of that now. And she joined me with the tea. It was Earl Grey with sugar. I remember it was really good. And I didn't realize it, but I still had that anti-Catholic pamphlet in my hand. And she asked to read it, and I gave it to her, and she read it. And then she started to cry, and I think her tears were more in shock and anger. And she said, "I'm Catholic. I don't go to church much," but when she pointed to a crucifix in the adjacent room. And then she and her three daughters drove me back to campus, and we talked in her van, the five of us, for, I don't know, maybe an hour. And by the time I sat behind the wheel of my blue Oldsmobile sedan alone, a weight had lifted off of me. I didn't realize at the time, but I had begun a transformation from a born-again Christian to what I call a born-again humanist, back to my more original self. And many years later, I found a UU church, or that UU church found me. So that chalice, that means a lot to me. Gloria. Her name was Gloria. A single mom from Ecuador. Gloria. Thank you.
You were at the first service. It is a hymn that's written by my friend Jason Shelton, and it is a universalist hymn. It's called "Love Has Already Won," and I want to invite you to rise in body or in spirit. And our choir members are going to help sing it, and invite you to give it a try and follow along as we close in song together.